Well, thanks for joining us on the SEABL Preview Show. I've been joined by League Manager Mark Quinn. Mark, thanks for joining us. Any results or unexpected outcomes from the last round, mate?
No, I think it went pretty much how everyone expected. Yep. You know, Geelong went 1-1 in Tasmania, which I think's not bad for them. You know, they only lost by a couple of points, I think 2 points in Hobart on Friday night. So, you know, they could have got 2-0. But I still think Paul O'Brien will be happy with a 1-1 result. Bendigo seemed to be just getting back into the rhythm and gelling. Yeah, they had a 2-0 record on the weekend, so I think they're starting to show that they're back into championship contenders.
I think of course, Knox over Dandenong, mate.
Knox over Dandenong, that was a big, massive surprise.
Yep.
But I think the biggest surprise for Knox was on Saturday night, they had Cassie Smith out injured. Callie Wilson injured herself in warm-ups. So they went into the game with Odette Andrew, Emily Freiters, Sinead Graves, and then 6 D-League players.
Yep.
And still were able to come out
Amy
with
Denson
a victory.
Amy Denson's still not in that
Amy
team.
Amy Denson was sitting on the sidelines. She still hasn't got her immigration paperwork just yet. So for them to come out and beat Sandringham as well as what they did on Saturday night with the team they had, I thought was an exceptional result.
Yeah, they're looking very good this year. We'll move on to the player of the week. Renee Camino, a couple of great performances against pretty good opposition.
She was very consistent in both games. Yeah. I think she got 19 points and 6 rebounds or something in both games. So that shows, you know, true consistency. And they need her to provide that quality production week in, week out for them to be successful.
In other news, Mel Cotter passed the 200-game milestone when Frankston played Ballarat on Saturday night. I was down at the stadium and I asked the Lady Blues head coach Steve Matthews what Mel Cotter brings to the team aside from just her experience.
Look, there's no fuss with Mel. Mel just gets the training every week, goes as hard as she can. You know, she's probably lacks a little bit of confidence, if anything, offensively. Like, I'm really encouraging her to shoot the ball, and she's doing a great job. 10 points a game, great defense. Like, she, you know, Taylor's a great player, and she did a really good job on her, especially early on. You know, and even at the end when she went back out onto her. So for someone that's 32, you know, you wouldn't pick it. She's fit as anything. You know, she just brings that no fuss, wants to win attitude, and she's great to have around. I think she can keep going for a couple more years yet. Yeah.
In other news, we'll look at some of the injuries and niggles that are starting to creep in, I guess, as the season unfolds. Kelly Wilson, as you mentioned, was unable to suit up in one game on the weekend, but I guess a real big one, Tegan Cunningham, out for what looks like 6 weeks with a broken finger.
It's a huge loss for Sandringham. She just provides that team with so much offensive power, and for her to not be there for 6 weeks, they're going to struggle. So I think Alex Palazzolo's got a few, you know, things to think about. I think Ash Stonehouse at Ballarat.
They're missing her
a lot. She's one of those Melanie Cotter type players that she may not provide a lot of offensive scoring power.
But she's a great role player.
Yeah. So she's a huge loss for Ballarat as well at the moment.
Yeah, I guess as the season unfolds, those injuries will... How teams manage those injuries, rather, will prove who can really stand up. But we'll take a look at the star performers. We'll put them all up at once. Are there any there, Mark, that stand out amongst all those star performers for you?
I think the one that really stands out for me is Chantelle Pereira at the moment. She is their only go-to player at the moment, but she has really shown that she can be that sort of go-to player that they need. She's leading the scoring with 21.2 points per game. She's averaging 4.3 assists per game.
Yep.
I think she's still getting a few rebounds as well. So she's having an MVP caliber type season. So that's one of the players that has surprised me so far.
We'll move on to the game previews now, and only 2 game previews this week because we're also going to look at the championship ladder. And the first game we're going to look at is a game between 2 championship contenders, we think, in Dandenong and Bendigo. Bendigo probably got a point to prove, while Dandenong want to bounce back after their showing last week, Mark.
I can't explain what's happening with Dandenong at the moment. They've lost 3 games already this year.
Yeah.
They only lost 3 games for the entire season last year.
Right.
So does that sort of show what sort of season they're having? And they've got pretty much exactly the same team as what they had last year.
Bendigo, on the other hand, let's talk them up. We obviously, you know, had our doubts in some respect when you make wholesale changes like they did at the start of the year, but they look rejuvenated. Jane Chalmers really looks like she's taken over the reins there on court. And they're looking like, you know, they could push Dandenong all the way this week.
Yeah, we were very suspect on them at the start of the year. Absolutely. We didn't know what they were going to like because they only had, what, two or three players come back from the previous year. Yep. So they are starting to gel, and I think they will. They'll see this is a great opportunity to get a victory. Yeah. They know Dandenong's not playing very well at the moment. To get a victory over Dandenong early in the season could be very beneficial for them come later in the year when it comes down to head-to-head in regards to playoff position.
Well, the next game we're going to have a look at is a game between the two teams that played in the 2009 Championship Final, Brisbane and Knox. Brisbane haven't had a massive start to the year, Mark, but, you know, we can't write them out fully just yet, can we?
No, not yet. They've only played two or three games.
That's right, yep.
They've had a lot of players come in and out.
Yep.
They've got a lot of young kids coming in. Rebecca Schatz comes back this week. She did her ACL in the first game last year. This is her first game back. She's a huge bonus for them, but having had 12 months off, you know, she may be a little bit underdone. Knox, they're going into the game unknown. As I said, Cassie Smith, Callie Wilson all sat out last week due to injuries, so they're day by day. So if they're out again this week, you know, they're vulnerable. Amy Denson, still waiting for immigration paperwork. Will she play? So this game is a real unknown. The other factor, Shona O'Bree for Brisbane. She announced her retirement last week, so she's going to want to go out with a victory this weekend.
And the players might lift for her.
The players will lift for her. Yep. This is a dangerous game for Knox Raiders.
Yeah, of course, it's always fatigue playing up there in Brisbane. But one of Brisbane's, I guess, key players over the years has been Rachel Pryor. And I spoke to her former head coach, Donna Rinaldi, when I was at Frankston.
I think Rachel's super quick. She's nice and athletic. She chases boards. She's just such a competitor. She's just a great person to have on your team at trainings and things like that. She really does have a case of white line fever, which is good. I think she's one of the most underrated players going around the league. I think she's got a bit of a mixed bag with it. She can do lots of things, you know, pretty well. She can shoot the perimeter and things like that. But Rachel Pryor for me, you know, she's a good pickup for any team in Brisbane. I'm lucky to have her.
So Donna Rinaldi there reflecting on how important Rachel Pryor is to that Brisbane team. But something Cheryl Chambers has brought over with her from Kilsyth to Knox is the defensive strategies, Mark, something you've picked up on in the stats this week.
Extremely. We had a look at the points for and points against. Knox currently keep their teams to 59 points a game, which is the lowest of all teams. So that's a massive factor for Knox. And if they can keep Brisbane to a low score this week. Brisbane aren't a very high scoring team, so it may be an easier task for Knox this week. But to have so many young girls in her team at Knox, and to have such a defensive orientated concept when she goes onto court, that's big for Knox. So if they can keep having teams below 60 points, they're going to go
very
far.
They'll win a lot of games, no doubts about it. We'll now move on, Mark, and we'll have a look at the conference tables, if you like. In the East Conference, Geelong and Bendigo are the top two spots, Frankston and Dandenong. Can you see any of those bottom three teams in the East moving up?
Dandenong lose this week. They can drop out of the four. Now, who would have thought that 3 weeks ago that we would be sitting here going, Dandenong may not be in the four next week. The other thing is Canberra there on 1 and 3, sitting on bottom of the ladder. They've got two winnable games this weekend. So if they win both of them, they're back 3 and 3, 50%. They will move up in the ladder. So it's early games yet, and I think the ladder's still, you know, very unknown in the East.
In the South, we've got Knox and Kilsyth there, Hobart and Nunawading. Ballarat, I still have a hope that they could push up, mate. That's not set yet either, this table.
No, I think Knox and Kilsyth are pretty much comfortable sitting there in 1 and 2 position, and I think too many other teams in that conference are going to get close to them this year. But I think you're right, Ballarat, they're going to be the team that I think are going to be fighting at the end of the year for a playoff position, just for the fact that Nat Taylor's missed a few games, and, you know, that could be the downfall for them. But we heard on the weekend that apparently they've got an import coming soon. So
could change things up.
Change things totally.
We'll have a look at the rest of the fixtures from round five. Are there any that stand out amongst those, Mark, that are particularly interesting?
Not any more than we've already spoken about. I think, as I said, Canberra have got two winnable games. Michelle Cozier is back this week. So she's going to give Canberra just, I think, that offensive power they've been lacking the first couple of games. She is only playing the game against Ballarat. She's not playing on Sunday against Sandringham. So I think with her inclusion on Saturday night against Ballarat, that's a definite winnable game for them.
Okay, well, that just about does it for us here at this edition of the Preview Show. Remember, you can get all the latest headlines by following us on Facebook or on Twitter. But until next week, it's bye from me and Mark.